Hi. My daughter's at an age where she sees me playing a game she's desperate to join in, which for me is a complete dream. Apart from one thing, I fear for my controllers. So I thought, why not make her a controller? What better place to start than this? But rather than destroy her one, I went to a local charity store and picked up this one. So the first thing I'm going to do is sterilise it, then after that I'm going to open it up, measure it up, and make a plan. As I've already made a number of videos taking these apart, I think it's best for both of us if I just skip over this part, but rest assured it needed a good cleaning. Initially I was planning on designing and making a new PCB to replace the existing one, but looking at the board now I think the best option is probably just to use this one. The switches are obviously in perfect places, and I can just solder up to these test points. So now I need to work out which test pans relate to which switches. So for that I just need to hold it whilst measuring the resistance and pressing the buttons. As you can see, the switches are still in circuit, so it's not a complete break, but just a dip in resistance, which I'm hoping is enough for me to register a press. So after going through all the switches and the test points, you can see they line up like this. Switch 4 goes to test point 13, switch 5 to test point 14, and so on. I mean, you can see it's on the screen. It's just there. So how am I going to turn this into a controller? Well, my plan is to use an ESP32 microcontroller. They're cheap and they have built-in Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, with my aim being to turn this into a Bluetooth controller, which I'm guessing the title gave away. There's a lot of options out there for boards, so I went with the Fire Beetle ESP32 by DF Robot. The most important part of the board is here, and I could have bought that on its own for cheaper, but it's a faff to work with unless you're making your own board, as I'd need to make the 5V to 3.3V conversion, as well as the charging circuit. And let's face it, I'm not going to make a smaller version. And here it is. The front's got everything I've shown, and the back's got a fairly detailed silk screen, letting you know the pin layout. So to connect it to the controller, I'm planning on somehow sticking it to the back of the controller's PCB and wiring it round to the front. But before I wire it all up, I want to write a small test program to make sure I can get something simple working. When starting to write the code, I luckily found an ESP32 Bluetooth gamepad library, which will make things considerably easier. So I've got a simple program on there that should register one button. I'm just going to use a wire to short the ground pin to the one I programmed. I mean, come on, it's essentially done. How good is that? Okay, now I'm going to hook it up to a button on the controller to make sure that works. Moment of truth. Oh, it's so good. I can't wait to get the rest of it hooked up now. So the next step is to write all the code so I know which pins I need to wire up. So that took a lot longer than I was expecting. The library I was using went through quite a big update and I didn't notice, and the version I was using was out of date to the docs I was looking at, which kind of explains why things weren't working. But I got past that hurdle. The next hurdle I had was with the ESP32 low power mode. They have a sleep and hibernation mode, and you should be able to enter those modes and exit those modes when needed. But I kept running into issues where it'd either get stuck in hibernation or never go into it. So I've completely given up on that idea now after wasting a lot of time on it, and I'm just going to do something more physical with the power, like a switch. But regardless, hopefully all the code's there now so I can wire it all up and we can give it a test. I wanted to add solder headers to the Fire Beetle so I could wire it up to a prototype board and still have it removable, but I don't think there's going to be enough space inside the controller, so I'm going to wire it directly to the test pads, just like I did in the test. So let's hook it up. Talking about fitting it all in, to give me more room, I'm going to have to cut out the battery compartment. One issue is these posts. As you can see, they line up to the buttons to give more support when pressing. So it'd be nice to keep those. I'll cut around them and see how things fit. Nope, it's no good. They're gonna have to go. I don't think the missing post will really be that much of an issue, as she's not really gonna button bash too much, and there's not that much flex in the PCB. Okay, so after carving out the plastic from the piece holding in the thumbstick, it should all fit together like this. So I'm going to stick it in place with this weird sticky double-sided tape, and then I can just solder it up to the test pads. Beautiful. So, slight issue, the buttons don't work, despite them working in the test. I think it must just be the dip in resistance isn't enough to trigger a press. It could possibly be sorted with a pull-up or pull-down resistor, but I'm going to try cutting the tracks first to see if that fixes it, by taking the switch out of circuit. Nice. Well, I'm just going to do that for the other switches, as I think it'll be more reliable. So, the power. I got this small lithium-ion battery to use, but as I said before, I couldn't get the hibernation mode to work, so rather than just plugging it in, I'm going to wire it up to the original switch, so I can turn it on and off. I got this plug so the battery would still be removable, and I'll attach it to a strip board and stick it to the board. I just have to make a bit more room inside the case, as you can see, it's right where this post is. I'll cut that off and check everything fits. Great, and now to solder it all up. And to wire it to the switch, I'm just going to bend the legs up with the ones I need to solder. Then I'll solder the rest of the legs in to put it in place. And for the small plug, I'm just going to stick it in with the same double-sided tape. So to power the controller, I don't want to have to open it up every time to plug it in. So I want a port on the outside, and what better port to use than USB-C? I have this USB-C breakout board that I'm going to wire up to a micro USB cable so I can plug it in. It was actually cheaper to buy the micro USB cable and cut it up than it was to buy some connectors and have them delivered. For USB 2.0 and below, they just have these four wires: the 5V, ground, data plus, and data minus. And they're still available on USB-C for backwards compatibility. And that's what these four pads on the breakout board are for, and it's as easy as connecting them up. I'll then cut a hole in the top of the controller so it all fits in. Right, another issue. I was hoping to use the USB-C to update the controller as well. But USB-C, unlike previous USB generations, uses the same connector from both ends. So they can operate in two modes, a host mode or a subdevice mode. And the thing that determines which one it should act like is a pin being connected to either a pull-up resistor or a pull-down resistor. Well, I bought these cheap boards. They had no documentation or resistors attached. I tried bridging the contacts on the back with a resistor as close to the 5.1 kilohms as I could, but I couldn't get the computer to recognize it. So for now, it's just for charging, and I'll try and look at sorting it later. And there it is. So now I'll put a liberal amount of glue on the back to hold it in place. And with that all done, I can finally reassemble it all. And also with it all assembled, I can at last put the battery in. And with it in and plugged into the USB-C, you can see that it's charging from that red light, which I should probably make visible on the front somehow. Well, looks like I don't need to worry about the charging LED, as it just shines through the case anyway. Not sure how clear that is showing on camera, so I'll just turn down the lights and hopefully you can see the nice glow. And when it is fully charged, the red light goes off. So here it is. We have a D-pad, the A, B, X, Y buttons. This is start, and when you slide this, it's the same as pressing select. And these are just for fun. So does it work? Obviously it's got limited buttons, making it perfect for retro gaming. And there it is, connected to my Mac. I'll try it against a few games in OpenEMU. OpenEMU is a really great all-in-one emulator app for macOS, and it's a really handy tool for playing all your backed up ROMs. Here we go, let's try a bit of Kirby. Great, well all the controls seem to work, so let's go through it a bit more methodically. Okay, here we go, now you can see me pressing the buttons. So that's the start working. And we've got left and right. And A. And here we have B for jump and spin jump on A. Probably a bad test as both X and Y are dash. And there's down and up. Right, now I just need to go to get a reserve item so I can show select working. This is actually pretty good. The buttons are all right. They're not too laggy. It's a lot better than I thought it'd be. Well, there we go. All right, so sliding this and boom, pressing select. So here it is connected to my Nvidia Shield, which would be handy if I ever lose the remote. Let's see how it fares against a few games in RetroArch. And that's no configuration needed, it's just working like that out of the box. Not necessarily an ideal layout. I'll probably want to remap it for a few systems, but this isn't bad, it's definitely playable. Okay, let's try another system. Well, Kirby's already a favourite of my daughter's, so this one's definitely going to get a play. And to show it's not just Nintendo systems that are going to get a look in, here's a bit of Sonic. Obviously, this is now a great controller, but I can't help notice that compared to this, there's something missing. That's right, a configuration app. So if you're wanting to quickly switch a button layout from a Nintendo-style ABXY to a more Xbox-style BAYX, then you can. It doesn't match up with the buttons on the front, but come on, they've got CD on there. That's just madness. And the fact that everything I've used it with so far lets you map the button layout, it's kind of beside the point. To do this, I enable the Wi-Fi and I send all the settings over there. I store it to the EEPROM, so even when it's turned off, the settings still remain. And I can even change the settings on the fly in case someone's using it and at risk of beating my high score. So there we go. I'm pretty pleased with how it turned out. I mean, it'd be nice with a few extra buttons and maybe a working thumbstick, but maybe there'll be a version 2. So now for the real test, Let's see what my daughter thinks.
A few minutes later.
She said she wanted to play with unicorns instead. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching. Subscribe.
A prophylactic wrapper.